Good afternoon, everyone. Good afternoon.
Okay. I'll give you my insights.
I think we've got a few more people coming in, some students that just got out of class, but we'll go ahead and get started. I'm Vildan Teske with the law firm of Teske Micco in downtown Minneapolis, and I'm the co-chair of the Diversity Committee of the Minnesota chapter of the Federal Bar Association, along with my co-chair, Federal Magistrate Judge Tony Leung, who could not be here today. Welcome to all of you, and thank you for being here. We are thrilled to have such a great panel and moderator for this very important topic today. But before I introduce our speakers and our moderator, I would like to thank a few people who made this all possible. First, I'd like to thank the University of Minnesota Law School Student Division of the Federal Bar Association, with whom we're co-hosting this event. And special thank you to several individuals from the law school division. In particular, a big thank you to James Soper, Devin Driscoll, and Rachel Cardwell, who are the leadership members of the law student division. Thank you for all your hard work. Also, a big thank you to Danielle Mayer, who is the career law clerk to Federal Magistrate Judge Becky Thorson, who has put in a lot of work in putting this together with our other leaders. And we would also like to thank our sponsors for this event, and they include the Minnesota Department of Administration Council on Developmental Disabilities, Student Unions and Activities Grants Initiatives, Coca-Cola, and University of Minnesota Professional Student Government. And then a few housekeeping items. We have been awarded one CLE credit for this event. It is regular credit. Unfortunately, we did not get the elimination of bias, so just want to let you know that. And also, I've been asked to announce an event that the FBA Minnesota chapter is holding later this week on Thursday, called the Emerging Professionals Conference. And it's a national conference that's being held here in Minnesota by the FBA. And it is intended for law students and young attorneys, and we would welcome all of you to join us there. There will be programming at the Minneapolis Club during the day, geared toward law students and young attorneys, or newer attorneys. And then in the late afternoon, early evening, there will be a reception at the Federal Courthouse in Minneapolis. So please join us if you have time. And if you'd like more information, we have David Goodwin, who is sitting up there. Do you want to wave? Please talk to him to get more information about it. All right. And now our speakers. I'd like to make some short introductions. We really had to pick from a lot of amazing things that each of our panel members and moderator have done over the years, but here are just a few of their many accomplishments. To my far right, Sarah Bessell is a staff attorney at the Human Trafficking Pro Bono Legal Center in Washington, D.C., where she conducts research on accountability for human trafficking victims. Ms. Bessell has a background in international human rights and conflict prevention, with a JD from the George Washington University Law School and an MA in conflict resolution from Georgetown University. She previously spent time in Cambodia, where she worked in the office of the International Co-Prosecutor of the Khmer Rouge Tribunal. And before that, she worked on international conflict resolution issues at the University for Peace in Ethiopia and at the U.S. Institute of Peace. Thank you for being here. To Ms. Bissell's left is John Choi. Mr. Choi is the Ramsey County District Attorney. He holds a bachelor's degree in psychology from Marquette University, a JD from Hamline University School of Law, which of course now has a new name, and he was a Humphrey Fellow at the University of Minnesota. Since taking office in 2011, He has become a state and national leader in the fight against sex trafficking. His innovative approach to holding abusers accountable while working collaboratively with advocacy agencies to help victims has transformed the way government intervenes in domestic violence and sex trafficking situations. Thank you for being here. And to Mr. Choi's left is our moderator, Judge Donovan Frank. Judge Frank is a graduate of Luther College and Hamline University Law School. After 13 and a half years on the state court bench, Judge Frank was appointed to be the 31st federal district judge for the District of Minnesota in 1998. Judge Frank is the recipient of numerous, and I do mean numerous, awards, too many to include in this brief introduction, but some of them include the following: the ARC Minnesota's 2016 Luther Granquist Systems Change Award, the 2015 City of Bloomington Human Rights Commission's Omar Bondarud Award in recognition of outstanding service in human rights, the 2014 Southern Minnesota Regional Legal Services Lifetime Leadership Award, the American Bar Association's 2012 Paul G. Hearn Award for Disability Rights. And I could go on and on, but I won't. So, and Judge Frank is very active in the Minnesota chapter of the Federal Bar Association, for which we are very grateful, and works with the Disability Justice Foundation on the pressing issue of discrimination of students and adults based upon disabilities, as well as attempting to increase the legal representation for individuals with disabilities. And before I turn it over to, I've got a couple more things. Let me continue on here. To Judge Frank's left, we have Tracey Perzel. Ms. Perzel is a graduate from the University of St. Thomas and then the University of Minnesota Law School, and she's a career prosecutor. She has handled criminal cases since 1999 as an assistant county attorney, an assistant state attorney general, and most recently as an assistant United States attorney. At the U.S. Attorney's Office, she has served as a senior litigation counsel, and for the past 3 years has served as the chief of the criminal division. To her left is Abigail Sterner. Ms. Sterner received her BA from Concordia College in Moorhead in sociology and religion and has been a legal advocate for the St. Paul and Ramsey County Domestic Abuse Intervention Project, known as SPIP, since 2010. Ms. Sterner has extensive experience in facilitating education and support groups for victims of domestic violence and reaching victims who are incarcerated. She developed SPIP self-sufficiency services and was the first light program advocate, partnering with police in determining the lethality of reported domestic violence crimes and providing specialized services to victims at greater risk of imminent harm. She also facilitated a coordinated response team consisting of law enforcement, prosecution, and probation to successfully identify highly lethal offenders in the Ramsey County community, collaboratively ensure increased protections to victims, and hold dangerous perpetrators accountable for their violence. And now, before I turn it over to Judge Frank, we do have a special video from Senator Amy Klobuchar, who wanted to be here today but was not able to. But as you can imagine, she has a full plate in Washington, D.C. right now. She is a national leader in the fight against sex trafficking, and I will go ahead and turn it over to you. Thank you.
Hello to everyone gathered for today's panel on sex trafficking of persons with disabilities. I think you know I'd much rather be there with you in person. This is such an important topic, but there's just a few things going on right now, and I'm honored to join you via video. I'd like to thank the Minnesota Federal Bar Association's Diversity Committee and the University of Minnesota's FBA chapter, my friend Judge Donovan Frank, your moderator, and all the great experts on the panel. Everyone, thank you for coming to learn about how to help bring justice to trafficking victims everywhere. As you all know, millions of people around the world fall victim to trafficking every year, and some of the most vulnerable are people who have disabilities. This doesn't just happen in faraway places, it also happens here at home. And by the way, when I was Hennepin County Attorney, I can't tell you the number of cases we had where people would prey on people with disabilities. They look for vulnerable people, and when they find them, they try to use it to their advantage. It is one of the saddest things, and that's why I'm glad that you're focused on this. Here's an example. A few years ago in our state, a 12-year-old girl got a text message to go to a party. A man picked her up in a parking lot and raped her. She ended up in a hotel and was forced to take explicit pictures of herself. They were posted online. She was sold to two more men. Law enforcement got that guy. He was convicted by a jury and sentenced to 33 years in prison. Trafficking and exploiting young girls haunts us, and it should. That's why we've all come together. And I'm pleased to say that Congress has actually made some progress on this front. Senator John Cornyn and I led the Justice for Victims of Trafficking Act, which was signed into law in 2015. Our legislation tackles it head-on by getting law enforcement resources and helping victims to get their lives back on track. It also includes my provision to help ensure that minors sold for sex are treated as victims, not as criminals. That provision was modeled after Minnesota's Safe Harbor Law, and it gives incentives to states when they're applying for federal grants to have a law in place that says, you're a young person, you're not the perpetrator, you are a victim. Another area where we've made some progress is in training those on the front lines to see the signs of trafficking. Last year, Senator Warner and I introduced the Stop Trafficking on Planes Act to provide this type of training to airline employees. The idea actually came from the flight attendants, and I couldn't believe their stories of what they'd seen on planes and how they were able to figure out that young people were being trafficked. This was actually signed into law that requires the airlines to do training of their employees to spot sex trafficking. But airlines aren't the only industry we should rely on. We're working with the trucking industry, the hotel industry, and others to continue our progress. I love the name, Truckers Against Trafficking. Not only does this have the virtue of having a bunch of eyes and people out there helping to look for this, it also makes them buy in because they're part of the solution. We must build on our success, because there's still much more to do. So before we get back to work, I just want to thank you so much. You know how fragile the lives are of people with disabilities. And the last thing their families want to think is that we're allowing perpetrators to actually target them because of their disability. Whether it's a physical disability, and I saw some of those cases when I was a prosecutor, whether it's a learning disability, and we saw those as well. It is just so sad. You know, a few years back, Cindy McCain and Heidi Heitkamp and I went down to Mexico, and we worked with their government and their U.S. attorney on how to handle trafficking cases together. We went to a shelter there. People were pretty talkative. We met a lot of the young people who were staying there. But there was one girl I'll never forget. Her name was Paloma. That name actually means dove in Spanish. And unlike the other girls in the shelter, she wouldn't speak to us. She only cried. It made me think of the Syrian refugee that I met once in a Jordanian refugee camp, who told me that what she had seen in her lifetime, lives taken in front of her, family members slaughtered. She said what she had witnessed would make stones cry. Through Paloma's silence, I knew that's what she was telling us too. She was telling us that what she had seen would make stones cry. So that's what you're all about today. It's helping girls like Paloma, helping those that actually maybe don't have the voice or the ability to speak for themselves, and that's so many of our most vulnerable citizens. Thank you, and I look forward to hearing what you talked about and working with you going forward. Thanks a lot.
I'd like to thank the panel members, but I'd like to thank Senator Klobuchar, because even though we were hoping she could be here, and then we asked for a short introduction, I think you can, at least what I see, is someone who has the care and concern and compassion for this topic, and some good things are happening in these complicated times we live in Washington and elsewhere. So why don't we, if I could begin with this, and it won't be an entirely unusual way to start a panel, I'd like to ask the same question of the four of you. Maybe we can just go from Sarah down the line, and as we begin, and I'll ask it this way, and whether I ask it in terms of, well, what's changed or what's happening, and now even the panel members, let alone all of you folks, are saying, what's he talking about? Well, let's face it, until the last couple of years, we wouldn't be having a get-together on sexual trafficking. You start hearing the phrase, and you might, and especially when we're going to also focus on individuals with disabilities. And so I guess perhaps whether it's an increase or it's more sensitivity or it's just a new issue, why now? What's happening? Maybe, Sarah, we could start with you and we'll walk right down the line. That's all right.
Sure. So I don't. So at the Human Trafficking Pro Bono Legal Center, HT Pro Bono, we maintain federal databases of every civil and criminal human trafficking prosecution and civil case. So what we're relying on in our research is actually prosecutions. So when we were looking into our database and mining the trends, we saw that there was a slight uptick in the number of cases, criminal cases, involving persons with disabilities. So, you know, it's hard to say just from reading the court documents whether or not that's an increase in sensitivity. You know, we have to applaud the prosecutors across the country that are bringing more of these cases that involve this victim population. But I also do think that, you know, due to the credit of anti-human trafficking organizations and disability rights organizations, there has been, in the past 20 years, an increase in attention to the abuse and exploitation of people with disabilities.
John? So from a broader perspective in Minnesota on the issue of sex trafficking, we have in Minnesota come a really long way. I mean, 6 years ago, we wouldn't be in the same room talking about this topic because it just wasn't on the radar screen. You know, in the criminal justice system, we are a complaint-based system. We are a response-based system. And so in other words, unless somebody raises their hands and says, this is happening to me, oftentimes those types of situations get missed or they're not something that people are dealing with. I mean, if you asked a police chief in Greater Minnesota 6 years ago whether or not human trafficking was happening in their community, they probably would have said no. Today, there's much more understanding of how this all happens. And trafficking, the exploitation of people, it's always vulnerable people, so people with disabilities are just something that layers the complexity of bad people taking advantage of others. It's always been going on. In fact, you know, there's been a lot of statistics out there that talk about Minnesota or the metro region being the 13th largest population center in terms of trafficking. Well, we're probably the 13th largest in population. So to commensurate with the demand, because this is all driven by the demand, it's always existed. But what we're doing now in the state of Minnesota is we're building a better awareness. Police officers can identify these situations, child protection workers. So we're building this infrastructure, and we're really doing, I think, a really great job in Minnesota to identify these situations much better, and then actually doing something about it in terms of investigations and prosecutions, but also in our child protection responses as well.
Tracey, from a federal perspective.
I agree with much of what John said. It's about awareness, largely. Exploitation has always existed. That's what we have a tendency to primarily prosecute, whether it's exploitation in the financial arena, exploitation of human beings. Exploitation is oftentimes what drives crime. When you shine a light on that exploitation and people become aware that it exists, and that it's not the fault of victims and it's not the fault of the person that was exploited, people are more willing to and more likely to come forward and report it, feel comfortable talking about it, not feel ashamed about it, not feel like they're going to be blamed by whether it's the police officers, criminal justice system, because of what happened to them. In our office, we began an initiative 3 years ago under former United States Attorney Andy Lugar that focused on human trafficking, because as John stated, this is a series of trauma-based events that get these victims to where they are. And he felt, former United States Attorney, felt that to be a very important area on which to focus. So that's what we've done. We partner with NGOs, non-governmental organizations, other governmental organizations that aren't prosecution or law enforcement entities, as well as law enforcement and other prosecution entities, to try to share the knowledge that we have about the cases that we've worked and gain the knowledge that they have in their special areas of expertise in order to further ferret this out and to draw people out of the shadows to report these crimes, because they're obviously very traumatic and heartbreaking. So if we can get people to be aware of them, I think, as John said, it's about awareness, and that's what we've been better at, in my opinion.
And just to kind of further echo what others on the panel have already said here today, being part of having the perspective of being an NGO, a non-governmental organization, that openness from our partners, our criminal justice partners and our civil partners, asking for that information too. And what we've seen on a state level with the trafficking, we're also looking at it. It's unique within the different refugee communities and immigration communities that we have here, especially in Minnesota. We have a large refugee and immigrant population, and you have to treat those different populations and tailor your response to that culture. So kind of like what John Choi said, the topic came up about human trafficking, just an example, human trafficking within the Southeast Asian communities, Hmong communities, where traffickers are going over to Thailand and other places, marrying or having and getting wives, and then sending them back here, flying them back here, and then start trafficking them with the hopes and dreams that they're going to be have a better life in America, all those other things. And then all of a sudden, when the coalition started talking about this, the Somali community started raising their hands and saying, hey, we're dealing with something like this too. And then another organization here and here and here. So just instead of working in these silos, working as kind of partnered agencies between that.
So let me, if I may, Abby, how does someone, whether they're a hotel owner, a citizen, young person, old person, law enforcement, non-law enforcement, and hopefully just concerned citizen, and we'll get to the, of course, the specialized roles here. How do we recognize the warning signs of you know? Because I'm afraid what you're going to tell us, and we're going to learn is a lot of these things are happening in our midst, right in front of us. And I would say that even if I have, so we can't talk about pending cases, but I have the new 17. Defendant sex trafficking case in the federal court, but what are the signs? What should be looking for? And then maybe we'll follow up too with that with Sarah as well.
So a lot of like kind of the red flags to look for when either you are suspecting or you see or suspect that something's not right. So things of the person who you believed is being trafficked is not allowed to have an opinion on a lot of things, is not allowed to have a say, or they tell you like, oh, I can't answer that question, or I'll have to ask my partner that before I'm able to. Also being isolated, so if they were able to go and do A, B, and C, now all of a sudden they're not able to go and do the errands that they were typically able to do, or their new caregiver is telling them that they're going to take care of that, and you never see them outside of their home. Just
can,
an isolated
and can you,
factor.
I'm sorry, Derek, can you follow up on that too? And I'm sure a couple of others are going to want to say, because I think we do, since we're focusing in on the individual disabilities, that we're also talking about caregivers and some other individuals too.
Absolutely. So, and a lot of times, people who are being sex trafficked, they know their trafficker. They know they're either some sort of acquaintance, a friend, family member, or they're an intimate partner with that person with a disability who is being sex trafficked. So there's that added investment on that on the victim's front of, this is the person that's supposed to love me, this is the person that's supposed to take care of me, this is the person that is taking care of my finances, and they're trying and they're supposed to look out for my best interest. So it's very similar to with domestic violence victims, that isolation factor, that fear of not being able to make a judgment or if that if they or a decision for themselves, because if they are, the repercussions. Those are things to look out for. And it can be more of a challenge depending on the disability that the person, that the victim has. If it's a cognitive disability, physical disability, mental health as well. And that fear of not being believed if they come forward is another big one. So even if you do ask these questions, you may not get answers, but that's kind of an answer within itself, right? That they're not able to give you a direct answer. Those are some of the basic red flags, I would think.
Can I ask Sarah, and I'm not trying to interrupt or control the flow here, but the what sorts of disabilities, if we want to tell everybody gathered here, the type of disabilities that, you know, that you're all seeing, and then what we, so we can't, so we're not naive or ignorant about such issues or any assumptions or stereotypes that we may make.
So in our research, we have seen fewer cases involving persons with physical disabilities. So one of the first cases actually recognized as human trafficking in the United States was a case over in the 90s, back in the 90s, involving Mexican nationals who were deaf. That's really one of the only physical disabilities that we've seen. The majority of cases involve persons who have intellectual, cognitive, or developmental disabilities. So we've seen victims who have traumatic brain injuries and have a cognitive disability. We've seen victims with autism. And with that population, you find just in general that those persons have more limited communication skills. They interact with the world in a very different way. They perceive the world a very different way, and they might not be able to. It's hard enough for a person without a disability who is a victim of human trafficking to self-identify as a victim of human trafficking because of the extensive trauma. When you compound that with a person who has a disability, it makes it almost impossible for that person to self-disclose. So it is very important to educate ourselves and our communities around us on the warning signs of human trafficking. And so we at HT Pro Bono do a lot of extensive outreach to the medical community, the law enforcement community, just to be aware of the signs. So for instance, there was a case over in Ohio, USC Callahan, where the woman had a traumatic brain injury, had a cognitive disability, and her traffickers forced her into domestic servitude, but also sexually abused her. And so there's not, in addition to sex trafficking, there's a continuum of sexual abuse and exploitation that's going on. And her traffickers, in addition to doing all of that, they also purposely abused her. They smashed her hand with a rock. They kicked her in the hip with a steel-toed boot. They shot her with a BB gun on three separate occasions and hit her with a wooden fence post in the back, all for the purpose of sending her to the emergency room so that she could then be prescribed narcotics that they would then take from her to feed their addiction. So that's something that medical personnel should be aware of. Multiple emergency room admissions, not being allowed to speak individually to the doctor or law enforcement, as Abigail has said.
If I can ask both John and Tracy, how do these different disabilities and vulnerabilities, how does it affect both on maybe uncovering the abuse and trafficking, and then maybe proceeding with investigation and prosecution? That's probably a three-part question. And who wants to leap off the bridge first?
Well, I think we're getting so much better at identifying these situations and recognizing first, I think, that you have to think about where these things occur. And so there's a way that you can kind of systemically look at vulnerabilities and disabilities. So for instance, if we're talking about just vulnerability, because this is what this crime is all about. It's about people taking advantage of people with big, lots of vulnerabilities, right? And so, and disabilities certainly could certainly be in that category, but that's just many layers of it. So for instance, just by age, by virtue of your age, if you're, you know, 14, 15, 16, and you're going through a period of your life you're susceptible, you've got a layer of vulnerability. If you've run away from home, another layer of vulnerability. If you have some cognitive development, emotional health, mental health issue, another layer of disability. If you have a drug addiction, another layer of disability. So all of these things are perfect concoctions for traffickers, exploiters to take advantage of these situations. And as Abby talked about, it doesn't go into full-scale violence right away. Oftentimes, the vast majority of times, it's going to be somebody approaching somebody and saying, oh, you know, you're really pretty, or would you like to be my friend, and I'll be your boyfriend, and maybe you can stay here on my and sleep on my couch, you've run away from home. And then all of a sudden the moment comes and says, well, if you really love me, this is what you're going to do. And then when there's resistance or when there's something happening that strains that relationship, then it might get physical, threats of violence. So it's kind of that, all of this stuff is kind of layered on top of it. But, you know, we've had situations, maybe all of our victims, I can't even think of a victim in Ramsey County, and we've had lots of cases. I mean, there's these multiple things are all at play. And, you know, we have lots of victims that have emotional health, cognitive disability, drug addiction, all of that. And that is what happens in terms of, being taken advantage of by these traffickers.
So to follow up, how has it affected your prosecution, and how do we deal with and uncover and with these vulnerabilities?
I think it's a great question. I think we have to listen, right? I think we have to pay attention to small cues, small bits of information that are uncovered as law enforcement's doing interviews, as a social worker is meeting with a client, as a person at an NGO is somewhere and happens to strike up a conversation with a person sitting next to them. I think we all have that obligation and those opportunities. And it's whether or not we choose to listen and we choose to engage. Because it's easy enough to say, I don't want to be in the middle of this. I don't want to be involved. I don't want to ask. And I think we all have that obligation to, when presented with those moments, to be willing to ask and be willing to engage and be willing to be uncomfortable for a moment or two or more to try to help someone who's obviously in a very bad situation. In terms of uncovering these crimes, I think what it boils back to is being willing to meet the victim where they are. I didn't grow up in a context where my father committed suicide when I was 10 years old, or my step-sibling abused me sexually when I was 5, or my parents were drug addicts. Most of us, through the grace of God, did not experience those things. But many people do. And as John was saying, there are layers and layers of trauma that most of these people who are victimized experience. That's because they're perfect fodder for people who want to exploit them, right? You're not going to pick the person that's had the great upbringing and the great life and is confident and has two parents who care about them and listen to them and talk to them. You're going to pick the person who is weak and who you can best manipulate if you're a person who wants to engage in this kind of behavior. And so I think uncovering for all of us is about, as I said, meeting people where they are, being willing to listen, being willing to engage in a conversation. If you're a police officer, taking that extra minute when you respond to that call and you see something, you're not there for perhaps what you see, but you see something and it seems strange, and you're gonna ask the question. Because your obligation is bigger than, you know, turning a blind eye back to whatever it was that you saw and made you uncomfortable. In Minnesota, broadly, I think we've done a better job of treating victims as victims by passing legislation where victims aren't prosecuted. They're not part of the equation when it comes to charging, which is what it should be. They're victims. That's how we should handle them and approach them. And so I think just broadly, being willing to say, we care, right? We care. We're not going to prosecute you. We care. We want to listen to you. We care how comfortable you're going to be through this process and trying to have all of our steps and our approach be that we care. That goes a long way to making a successful investigation. and a long way to making a successful prosecution. I mean, all of us as prosecutors and law enforcement, we're a bit of control freaks. I may be saying something that's not obvious to everybody, but we are, and we want things to go the right way, and we, you know, care very much about our cases, and sometimes the playbook gets thrown out the window because this person at this time is not going to be able to do it in the way that you want them to, and you just have to be flexible enough to put it out there in the way that it's going to work, in the way that's going to show the jury what happened to this person.
So. I had a follow-up for Sarah and Abby, but John, I think Tracey touched on it, the safe harbor provision here.
Yeah, and I think it's a great opportunity to talk about, because I think what Tracey's talking about is really the premise of what makes the Minnesota model, where many states are looking at what we're doing here in Minnesota. And that all began really with, and I see Jim Backstrom in the room, but county attorneys originally took the lead back in February of 2011 to say that we would no longer prosecute those who had been prostituted because we believed them to be victims of crime and children in need of protection. That served as a basis of kind of a victim-centered response in law enforcement. And so if the orientation is to help these victims and recognize that these individuals, children, are victims, then what ends up happening is that there's a better relationship that's developed through law enforcement. And because many times these victims will believe that their trafficker is their friend or their boyfriend or whatever it is, that they're the ones that are taking care of them. But hopefully that dynamic switches, and then as a part of a prosecution, I really believe that the safe harbor approach has made all of the difference in the world in all of the cases. We've had just numerous jury trials in Ramsey County, and we've never lost. And in every one of those cases, the victims have courageously testified and told their story. And I think they were able to do that because of the work that nonprofits, victim advocacy organizations, and service providers are helping with the victims, the relationship that law enforcement has. And as Tracey talked a little bit about, these cases are really unpredictable because you just don't know what a victim might say. And in fact, most often, it's going to be very incongruent or inconsistent with the way a juror is going to see the world. So we spend a lot of time educating jurors as a part of how we present the case to them about making sure that they understand how victims who have suffered trauma, who are in these types of situations, because a juror might say, well, why don't you just leave? Well, no, it doesn't really work that way. And so we explain to the jurors kind of the trauma and the psychology of these relationships. And so that's a big part of being successful in the response, is just having that victim trauma-informed approach to how the interaction occurs, how we're providing services, and having that infrastructure in Minnesota. Because, you know, lots of states across the country, they might have a safe harbor law, but they don't have any money funding it. And you can't have a safe harbor unless you have infrastructure, meaning you've got shelter beds, you've got services, and we have that in Minnesota on a bipartisan basis. So I think that's really worked out really great.
And maybe we can follow up with both Sarah and Abby on that, but I want to thank John and Tracey, Jim Backstrom's in the room too, and perhaps others, that the educational process, then you put together with it the safe harbor. I can't tell you the number of victims with disabilities, especially the developmental disabilities, who people stereotype them unfairly. And you just heard John say, and I know Jim feels the same way, Backstrom, Tracey, rarely if ever is competency an issue. It's more the danger, the dangerous time is leaving a relationship and trying to get out. But it's nice to hear that people are not acting on these stereotypes of these victims. That doesn't mean it isn't extremely difficult. But with that in mind, what, Sarah and Abby, what should a person do when they recognize a vulnerable victim of trafficking? One, how do you recognize it in your experience and things you've done? And then, because I suspect there's been new challenges with the increase with people with disabilities who are victims of trafficking, what, how do you recognize it, and what should, for the benefit of me and maybe hopefully everybody, what should we do?
I think a lot of it is, like Tracey said, it's a lot about listening. You know, even if you were to ask a direct question of anybody who's gone through a traumatic experience, they may give an answer that seems completely out of left field. And one of the reasons is because they, when you experience trauma, sometimes you get stuck on focusing on certain things and not bigger picture things that a lot of times the criminal justice system, prosecution, investigators are trying to get at. So listening to tiny details when they're sharing with you what their daily life is like, how this person talks to them on a daily basis, and asking bigger, broader questions maybe about, you know, how are you feeling in your home? Are you feeling safe in your home? When that person does that, how does that make you feel? Have you felt pressured to do anything like that? And keeping it an open conversation without any judgment. And I think we're doing a very good job here in Minnesota with regards to victim engagement that way too. And also just asking, especially with working with persons with disabilities, asking them about their disability if you don't know about their disability. Because each one is going to be different and has different ways of dealing with their disability or maintaining their life due to it. And having that aspect of, okay, they have to do this a different way. Now I can see how maybe the trafficker is taking advantage of that sort of aspect. And then with things that you can do about it, asking them who do they feel safe talking to, where are safe places that they feel, letting them know of resources, like they can go to a shelter for a short time, or that there are if the person who is trafficking them is their personal care attendant or someone who is in charge of their finances, reassuring them that, you know, that person doesn't have to be that person, the person who's hurting you. It can be another person who's saying, I can help you figure out who that will be. So it doesn't become unmanageable for them. So
I would completely agree. And again, I would echo what Abby said earlier, is that it really, a lot of the time, it boils down to a gut instinct. You know, something is off. And, you know, I mean, the signs and recognition strategies will depend on who you are. So if you're a medical personnel and you think something's off, try and get the suspected trafficker out of the room, and try and talk with the victim. And it also, asking the direct question, are you a victim of human trafficking, will never give you the correct answer. don't do that. Because again, as I mentioned earlier, it's hard enough for a person without a disability to self-identify as a victim of trafficking, but you have to ask around the issue. So, you know, I know law enforcement, federal law enforcement, asks questions like of domestic servitude victims. When was the last time you had a vacation? When was the last time you went to the dentist? Because in a lot of human trafficking, both sex and labor cases, the victims aren't allowed to go to the doctor until it gets really bad. So untreated physical illnesses or injuries is another sign. If you think another, specific to this victim population, another trend we're seeing is the targeting of victims for theft of their Social Security
income. Yeah, I was hoping you'd say that. Okay. When you told me about that, I mean, I just never even thought about it.
Yep. So not in every case we've seen does the perpetrator have an awareness that their victim has a disability. That's not 100%. Their disabilities might make them more vulnerable, and the perpetrator is acting on that. But in some specific cases, and I believe I have the fact sheet outside in the front, and we have all of the string sites and all of the more detailed case studies in there. But for example, there's a case, U.S. v. Weston, and that was a case in which Weston and her co-defendant specifically targeted six people with varying disabilities. They befriended them, they had them move in, and then they became their representative payee. And for those who don't know what that is, it is a person who basically takes charge of the benefits and distributes the money and takes care of that. So Weston would become the victim's representative payees and steal all of their money. And in the meantime, they essentially locked these victims up in attics. They moved around a lot. So attics, basements, when they were eventually found by happenstance by a landlord who was doing a routine property inspection, he went down into the basement and he found the victims in the basement in filthy conditions. And in fact, one of the victims actually was chained to the boiler. And so she was sentenced to, Weston was sentenced to life plus 80 years, and they were required to pay restitution. Unfortunately, not to the victims, but to the Social Security Administration. But but to get back to, you know, identification and what to do if you come across a victim with a victim of trafficking, you know, if you are doing it in your professional capacity, ensure that there are protocols in place. If you're a regular, if you suspect that they are having their Social Security benefits being abused by representative payees, you should contact your local disability rights organizations. And I believe there are representatives from Minnesota's Protection and Advocacy Organization in the room. Contact them because they have the capacity to monitor and investigate abuses of persons with disabilities. And lastly, you know, if you just have a hunch, either call the police or call the National Human Trafficking Hotline.
You want,
and that's the point that I wanted to make, that nobody in this room should ever think that you shouldn't call 911. If you have any suspicion or something, call 911. And it's we are very intentional about that in Ramsey County, because it's everyone assumes, like, oh, you know, only call 911 if it's a for sure emergency. That's not necessarily a case. You can call 911 and somebody will come out. In fact, I have a great story, because there was in Roseville a hotel clerk. Actually, she was the manager of the hotel, and her boyfriend was waiting for her to get off work, and her boyfriend noticed something was kind of odd at this hotel, because there was this younger girl. She was 17 years of age. And she was there with an older man, and he just knew that there was something not right about it. He talked to his girlfriend, the manager of the hotel. She agreed. Then they actually went on Google or on Backpage, and they actually saw somebody that looked like her. So they thought, concluded that maybe she is being trafficked. They called 911. And because of that phone call, we were able to intercept a situation in which a 17-year-old girl was being trafficked here in the state of Minnesota. And I have more stories just like that where people have done that. So if you see something or suspect something, it's okay to call, and I encourage you to do that. And I think another part, too, is if you're in a professional capacity, if some of you are going to be child protection attorneys or juvenile prosecutors or work for a general counsel of a hotel, there are things that you can do within your industry to be involved in this issue and become more aware. Like, just as an example, if you're working with runaway populations, well, 30 to 40% of all runaways are being sexually exploited and or trafficked. There's a huge connection with kids that are in our foster care system who end up becoming trafficked. We know that these instances occur oftentimes in hotels. And so it's great to see the hotel industry and lawyers that represent hotels becoming really actively engaged on training, you know, their employees and developing certain practices and protocols. Delta Airlines is doing something with their flight attendants, the Senator Klobuchar talked about. But just become more aware, and there's things that you can do depending on what you're doing as a profession.
Tracy, whether it's anecdotal, story,
I would just echo John's comment. I mean, if someone's going to call 911 about the dog barking in the backyard, which my husband's a police officer and they get those calls, you know what? A 911 call about something that just doesn't seem right is okay.
So can you, can sometimes I think people are wanting to say, well, can whether it's a lawyer, advocate, some of us, can they maybe tell us maybe a story or two, anecdotally or otherwise, about a victim they've worked with or something that comes to mind? Do any of you have something you'd like to share with the group that kind of brings that kind of human element to it?
You know, you heard, I can start with Senator,
yes,
Senator Klobuchar talk about a case of a 12-year-old victim who was raped by her trafficker and sentenced. That was a case our office prosecuted, the former United States Attorney Andy Lugar and Melinda Williams and Assistant County Attorney out of Olmsted County. That victim was 12 years old. That victim was in sixth grade. One of her parents had committed suicide. She was a drug addict, in part because the defendant made her a drug addict, because it made her pliable to him trafficking her. And she was sexually abused by one of her siblings when she was young. You know, so as when I said previously that we all have the good fortune, most of us, of not having been through situations like this, these are people who have really struggled and really suffered, and this is just compounding the struggling and suffering. We, as I mentioned before, really take the approach of trying to meet the victim where they are. That means that sometimes, you know, we spend a lot of time meeting with people in advance of charging our cases. meeting with people over the course of time as we're working on our cases once they've been charged to make sure that those relationships are cultivated. I mean, put yourself in the place of a sixth grader, you know, 12 years old. The most important thing that you'd hope you'd have to think about is, what am I going to get to do with my mom and dad on the weekend? Are we going to go to the zoo? That's not what these folks are thinking about. We take great care to introduce them to the court system, to the court process, to bring them up to the courtroom, to show them where they're going to be testifying, to show them where the trafficker is going to be seated, to show them how they don't have to look at that person if they don't want to. We ask them what would make them comfortable. For example, in a case that Laura Provenzino from our office tried, her victim had thought a lot about it and said, I just want to wear sunglasses. I just don't want him to, I don't want to have to look at him, and I don't want him to be able to see my eyes. And Laura worked with Judge Erickson on that, and Judge Erickson allowed that. It was great case law about people being able to testify in a manner that obscures the sight line of the defendant and being able to see them. So again, I think it's just, how do we approach this with a sensitivity and a compassion and a flexibility that allows for this person that we are really depending heavily on? I mean, those are the people that make these cases, not us. It's the victims. What are we able to and willing to do for them to make this as okay and humane as the criminal justice system can be?
Abby?
Yeah. I have a story that's a little bit more of a prevention story. The victim never actually got trafficked because of interventions beforehand that led to it. One of the programs that I've done for many years is called the First Light Program, where an advocate and an officer from our family violence unit partner together, assess lethality on the criminal, domestic violence, sexual assault cases that come in, and then go out to the homes of the victims. The officer does the investigation, and then the advocate's able to do safety planning. We went to, we had this case that came through. It was a senior citizen, and she had some physical disabilities as well as some mental health. So those were the vulnerabilities that she was dealing with. And a neighbor had called because of hearing noises upstairs. That's how the call initiated. Nothing about anything trafficking, nothing about domestic violence, nothing about just saying, hey, I'm hearing all these weird noises. Can someone do a welfare check? Turned out that her PCA worker, who was in charge of also her finances and was getting paid for taking care of her, had begun assaulting her. And that's all that when we went to the home together, we knew. So we knew it was a domestic violence case. That's what we thought it was going into it. The investigator gets what they need for the domestic assault charges. We're kind of sitting and then just talking and engaging with the victim, right? To let her know that we're there to sit, you know, to create a safety plan with her. And while we were talking and engaging with her, more and more things started coming out about how her PCA worker had been talking about how he wanted her to see her with other men. How her PCA worker said that he thought that would be very attractive, how that would make them some more money and help them with the finances in the home and everything. So it was, this guy was grooming her to start going into some trafficking expertise. But because a neighbor, someone said something's not right, something's going on, police got involved ahead of time and hedged that off before it got to that. And the relationship between the trafficker, the abuser, they had only known each other for less than 3 months. So it was something that was, it was on track to becoming trafficking, but it was able to hedge that off. That officer's now back on as a patrol officer and will sometimes just check in, stop by, say hi to her to make sure she's doing okay. They've created that relationship. So now that victim knows that there's people in her community that care for her and that she has avenues to do, to continue that interaction to stay safe.
Well, perhaps last words by each of you, because I think we promised to be in the neighborhood of 1215. So can we start with Sarah and kind of take a walk down the pathway here?
Yeah. I would just say that something that has struck myself and my colleagues at our organization in that, first of all, the theft of Social Security benefits is one thing that we were trying to spread as much awareness about. But in terms of this topic, sex trafficking of persons with disabilities, it's not, it's also not just the your more traditional commercial sexual exploitation. We're seeing a lot of cases involving forced labor, sexual servitude as forced labor, also extreme sexual violence and assault. And for whatever reason, the physical abuse is, in these cases, is very extreme. And we don't know that, we don't know why for sure, but we do believe that that is because of a larger problem of otherizing this victim population. And so while we've seen great strides in the disability rights community to move away from institutionalization and move away from group homes, and you're seeing less abuses in those contexts, although they're still, they still exist, there are new vulnerabilities that are arising in the individual integration context that we all should be aware of. So I think, you know, as you go out into the field or as you're doing your work, basically model what we're doing today is we're all about cross-cultural engagement within all the various communities. So we do a lot of outreach to disability rights communities to educate them about this, and then we receive education from them on how to be ADA compliant and how to work with this population. So it really just continue to expand your network so that we can continue to combat this.
Yeah. So I'll end with maybe what I want the audience to think about, you know, as we've been in this fight against sex trafficking here in the state of Minnesota, we have sent a lot of people to prison for decades. In fact, we've had a sentence for 58 years. And as I reflect on all of those people that have gone to prison, an observation that I would have about all of them is that I don't think that anybody in their life ever told them that men shouldn't do that. And then I think about all of the people, and vastly men, and I don't mean this to say that to indict men, just to invite the, maybe the men in the room to think about this, who are causing this problem because they're the demand, right? But oftentimes, I don't think that they're thinking that they're doing anything wrong. And I know that to solve this problem, we're not going to arrest or prosecute our way to a solution. I know that we're responding and we need to have accountability and certainly punish those who are involved in this crime. But if we really want to end this as a community, then I think we have to start thinking about, you know, some more important intentional conversations about how we raise boys and what other men expect of other men in terms of what's acceptable. Because if we really want to end the exploitation and the trafficking of vulnerable persons, then we need to start thinking and acting differently as a culture.
Tracey?
I agree entirely. And I'd add to that what we tell girls, right? Because we all know kids who may not have great homes. We all, you know, my young kids, I see that in kids in their school. And we all have opportunities to listen. And we all have opportunities to be that adult that reflects good values and shows kids who may not have that support structure at home, friends, family, that people care about you and people care about you having a life that you want to lead and not a life that involves being victimized. Wouldn't say those words, but sometimes just being a listening ear for someone is a really good thing. So I would echo John's words about conversations.
Abby?
Wow. Those are all really awesome answers to just take away from here. It's a lot of it is emphasizing, and I would emphasize a lot being a victim advocate, is that victim engagement, meeting them where they're at, having open conversations also just among your own friends and family about human trafficking and about people who are in vulnerable positions about that. I just... 2 weeks ago in my own personal life, my future brother and sister-in-law found out that their neighbor had been soliciting sex from young people within their community, and it was a part of this bigger human trafficking ring, and talking to them about how that affects them, how it affects their community, how they could never think that it was their next door neighbor. You know, and they live in a pretty affluent part of town. So talking about this and having those engaging conversations in our own personal lives is also how we're going to make an impact and making changes towards this.
And if I may make a comment or two before I turn it back to Ms. Teske, please remember, and I'm a bit old-fashioned, I guess, I think that most of us, especially lawyers, especially law students, especially people, we will be judged by how we care and take care of the most vulnerable and needy people amongst us. We should be judged as individuals, as human beings, and be aware of some of the stereotypes so many people have of individuals, especially victims, but especially victims with disabilities. And I still each day struggle with the silence of so many people in our communities. And to leave you with a quote I perhaps oftentimes overuse, but I so like the quote from Dr. Martin Luther King. And I quote, "In the end, we will not remember the words of our enemies, but the silence of our friends." And I think as a profession, as individuals, we have an obligation to speak out, to act out, and to help these individuals with disabilities in not just sex trafficking, but that's why we're here today. And I thank you all for coming today, and I'll turn it back to Ms. Teske.
Wow. Thank you very much for these great insights and for the information that you shared with all of us today.